if it does not improve his finances, then there is no value of a retrofit. There is no customer for a retrofit. So that's the most important. A retrofit. So the retrofit has to improve the financial situation of the customer. Then, of course, the customer may also have sustainability goals, like the big companies will have goals of reducing their carbon footprint. And so the retrofit certainly helps in that as well. And third, which we have seen recently in India, is about the end of life, where a scrapping policy is being introduced. You know, after 15 years, you cannot ply combustion engine vehicles. After 10 years in the national capital region, you cannot ply diesel vehicles. So a retrofit, if it's a full electric retrofit, it could potentially bypass that problem. Other stakeholders, society at large, very important need is public health and climate change, of course, global warming and other aspects of climate change. The government has certain needs. Government is an important stakeholder. GDP growth is also impacted by retrofits, in the sense that if pollution is reduced, if public health improves, there is improvement in the GDP of the country. And I will briefly touch upon it later as well. Crude oil consumption for a country like India, where 85% of India's crude oil consumption is imported. And if a retrofit solution can help reduce that, that's all to the good as well. Similarly, forest conservation, the country's own commitments on carbon intensity of development, what you call the nationally determined contributions under the Paris Accord. Industry has its needs. These are perhaps a little more subtle. The automotive industry generally tends to look at retrofits with a negative eye, but I would want to assure people from the industry, from the automotive industry, that adopting retrofit solutions and encouraging retrofit solutions will allow the Indian automotive industry to take leadership position in the electrification space. Retrofits, whether hybrid or full electric, are all electrification solutions. Today, India is still lagging behind large parts of the world in electrification. And retrofit solutions are easy, quick, and sustainable ways of developing the ecosystem. And of course, the industry needs to recognize that electrification is inevitable. And retrofit is one way of transitioning smoothly and painlessly towards electrification. A classic example is, you know, the dialogue about job losses through electrification. Retrofit solutions will avoid job losses to a very large extent. The little chart on the right you see is essentially showing that fuel price per capita income for a country like India is about 6 times the closest other country, which is Thailand, and just emphasizes the need to cut down on the carbon intensity of transportation. This is just to drive home the point that economic benefit is extremely, extremely important in the case of any solution, electrification being just one of those. This is again to drive home the point that despite the best efforts of many countries around the globe, including India, the carbon dioxide emissions are still increasing, still going up. It's only in the US and EU that we find some stabilization of carbon emissions, but worldwide it continues to go, and it's a matter of concern. I'm not getting into too much detail of all these things because a lot of you are already aware of it. I want to move on quickly to the specifics of retrofitment and particularly hybrid retrofitment. Some hard facts. Many of you may not be aware, there are 1.2 million people who die early every year in India alone due to poor air quality. 25% of this is attributable to road transport. 14 of the top most polluted cities in the world are Indian. We can go on down the list. There is a 5% GDP impact of air pollution. If air pollution is reduced dramatically, the GDP will grow and will help in poverty reduction as well. And of course, older vehicles tend to pollute more. And that's another factor in favor of retrofitment. Now, there are two types of retrofit. There is a hybrid electric retrofit or a full electric retrofit. Hybrid electric would be where the electric drivetrain is added on alongside the internal combustion. So both are working together. This is India. It is governed by the automotive industry standard number 123, AIS 123, part one and part two. Part one is for smaller vehicles. Part two is for larger vehicles. The cutoff is 3.5 tons. So vehicles which are less than 3.5 tons GVW are covered under part one of AIS 123. And hybrid electric retrofits will usually be torque assist systems. They will usually not permit electric only driving mode. And then of course, there are full electric retrofits, which are more popular in the DIY ecosystem in the US, for example, where the combustion engine and all related components are entirely removed and replaced by the electric drivetrain. In India, this is regulated by the same automotive industry standard, but part three. How does a hybrid electric retrofit system work? Now, this chart you see represents a typical drive profile of speed versus time, where you see dramatic start-stop movements, which are very, very inefficient for a combustion engine. When you install a retrofit system, a hybrid retrofit system, the electric motor essentially assists the combustion engine during acceleration. When you accelerate, there is a load on the engine, the electric motor will assist and reduce that load and therefore reduce the fuel consumption, leading to reduction in fuel as well as saving in emissions. But where does this energy come from? How does the electric motor assist? It's drawing its energy from the battery. Now, where does the battery get the energy? There are two options. There is an option to charge your battery from the grid, plugging into the system. What Altigreen decided to do was not to use any external charging at all. So there is no grid dependence. The entire charging of the battery comes through regenerative braking during when the vehicle is slowing down or coasting. So that energy, which would otherwise be waste energy, is now recovered. And I assume most of you understand regenerative braking. We save this to the battery. And then of course, the cycle goes on, sometimes as much as 5 to 10 times a minute because of the drive profile in India. Now these drive profiles are very similar to in India as in other developing countries, but very different from drive profiles in most of the developed country situations. You will see similar profiles in a place like, you know, maybe Milan or Manhattan or those places, but by and large, the drive profiles are different. What does a retrofit system consist of? You'll see these two or three big ovals. There's essentially a motor and a generator. It's the same piece of equipment or same component which works as a motor when you are accelerating and as a generator when you're decelerating. There is a drive controller, which includes the inverter, the DC-DC converter, and the brain, which you would call the ECU, you know, and associated components. And there's a battery pack, you should call it a storage system, because it could be lead acid batteries, it could be lithium ion batteries, it could even be ultra capacitors, and we work with all of them. There's a wire harness which has to connect all of these. These are the essential components of a retrofit system, and then there could be add-on components. You may need a gearbox, you may need a monitor to be aware of what's going on. These are the three key components: the motor, generator, the controller, and the battery pack. It's worth mentioning, blowing my own trumpet at this point, that the Altigreen's retrofit system, the Hypixi, has received 19 global patents across the world and is recognized as a unique retrofitment solution because it is hybrid, it covers a range of vehicles, and most importantly, it does not require any external charging. And I have to add, it provides substantial savings, which you will not see in mild hybrid systems. And I will come to that a little bit later. So having said this, what are the challenges that we have in a retrofit system? The most important challenge is a techno-commercial challenge. How do you provide significant assist at a low cost, at a cost which is acceptable to developing countries? The challenges of providing adequate power. There's a lot of research that needs to go in to determine how much power is needed. Do you need 3 kilowatts of power? Do you need 10 kilowatts of power? Do you need 20 kilowatts of power as a retrofit system to be meaningful for the vehicle? And then how do you fit that much power into an existing vehicle? If you open up the hood of a diesel vehicle, you'll find there is practically no space there. Now, if I need to put a motor which delivers 10 kilowatt of power, how do I make it small enough to fit into that little space? So that's just one example of the technical challenges that you see there. Then there is a marriage of two drives. There's a combustion engine, and now there's an electric engine. How do you make sure they work well with each other? There's no slippage. They don't cancel each other out. There are no losses, and so on. How do you develop enough regenerative braking to charge the battery pack sufficiently to provide meaningful assist? The storage technology, the cost of that storage technology, all of these are challenges. And these lead to the financial challenge that what is the cost of the product? If the cost of the vehicle is, let us say, 6 lakh rupees, and I provide a retrofit hybrid solution which is costing 2 lakh rupees, it's highly unlikely that the customer is going to be seriously interested. There will be a few technologically savvy adopters or people who want to be in the lead, but we will not cross the chasm of taking it mainstream. The other financial challenge is for that person, for that potential customer, what is the cost of fuel as a proportion of his total cost of operations? If it is only 5 or 10%, and we are providing a 20% saving through retrofitment, he's saving only 1 or 2% in his cost of operations. But if his cost of fuel is let's say 40 or 50 or 60% of his cost of operations, then it is meaningful. The other challenges are in terms of regulatory or policy challenges. For example, in India, the policy for type approval or homologation of retrofit solutions requires significant expenditure of time and money and repeated type approvals. We have worked closely with the government. There have been some improvements over the last 2 or 3 years, but there is a long way still to go on that. And then after the central approval is obtained, whether from ARAI or ICAT or anywhere else, there are state level approvals also required. And the final important policy challenge is that there is no government support for retrofits, whether hybrid retrofit or full electric retrofit. The FAME II subsidy scheme or the FAME II scheme, for example, has nothing for retrofits. And there are, of course, other challenges on the policy side as well, but these are the most important ones. At this point, I think you'll forgive me if I'm going a little fast, but I'm trying to complete in the allotted 15 minutes. What are the other challenges? Customer acceptance. How much confidence can we provide him that the benefits that are being promised will be obtained? What peace of mind can he be given? Most of the customers or the early customers for this will be commercial customers, whether they are carrying cargo or they are taxis or buses carrying passengers. A day lost, suppose there is a technical glitch and a day of driving is lost, they've lost their daily earnings. Most of them are self-owned entrepreneurs. They are driving a taxi or an auto rickshaw or whatever else it may be. They can't afford to lose a day of earnings. So customer acceptance is certainly important, cost, and then reversibility. When they sell their vehicle, the buyer may not be interested in a retrofitment, retrofitted vehicle. So the customer wants to know, can I reverse this and can I sell you back the retrofit kit so that I can sell my vehicle independently of the system? And the final challenge, of course, is on safety, you know, chances of fire, explosion, catastrophic failure, if the system is not fitted well, the vehicle balance. You know, OEMs have been making vehicles for decades, and they have made continuous improvement to this to the extent that these are now well-tuned systems. A retrofit system has by no means been tested for those decades. These are all recent developments. We do go through a very, very huge amount of testing, but it is not my claim that we've tested it for a billion kilometers. We may have tested for 500,000 or 1 million or 2 million kilometers, and that is extremely good, but it's not a billion, and therefore one has to be very, very careful before we put this out in the market. We have to be extremely confident that we've tested it in all conditions, and therefore safety has to be taken care of. It is of prime importance. I'll just give you some examples from our experience. Maruti Suzuki Swift Desire, we retrofitted and got type approved. You know the tagline of Suzuki's ads in India is "Kitna deti hai?" What is the fuel efficiency? I'm proud to say that we've been able to create a retrofit system for the Desire, which gives 20 to 25% improvement in fuel efficiency at a cost which is acceptable to the Indian market. And this has been tested over 70,000 kilometers. Similar example on the Toyota Etios. I don't need to tell you about Toyota's technological superiority, and the numbers speak for themselves. Again, a 24% improvement in that case. And then a cargo vehicle, Tata Ace, which is a workhorse of last mile delivery in the country, again tested over thousands of kilometers. And these are you know, customer drives. Very little of these are drives by Altigreen itself. These are drives which have actually been done by the customer, and there's customer feedback to us, where we see an improvement in mileage of over 20%. And another version of Tata Ace on the BS3. So these are just some of the examples. Then of course, the status and the future of retrofitment. I think it's fair to say that the possibilities are enormous, because the number of vehicles on the roads in India and other developing countries runs into tens of millions. And by no means all, but a large number of these are good targets for retrofit solutions. I think the potential to cut down greenhouse gases. See, one retrofit kit on fitted on one vehicle, let's say a taxi running in Bangalore or Delhi, can reduce carbon dioxide emissions by as much as 3 to 4 tons a year. Now, just to put that in context, 4 tons of CO2 avoided is like planting 1 acre of forest. Not one tree, not 10 trees, not 100 trees. It's like 1 acre of forest, a forest with trees and bushes and, you know, all of that. So that's what one retrofit vehicle can do. Now, if you plant, if you do a million retrofits, and just for context, again, there are 20 million cars on Indian roads today, or perhaps even more. So the possibilities are mind-boggling. They're enormous. But the status is, you know, even less than embryonic. I think the total number of retrofits, and Nakul will be speaking after me, he will correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the total number of serious retrofits in the country is less than 500. And so the future, of course, just, you know, remains to be determined. Thank you so much. That's the end of my presentation. I believe we will take questions afterwards. And I'm happy to hand over the mic back to Dr. Praveen or to Nakul.
So thank you, Mr. Shalendra. to sharing your experience and giving very useful insight about the retrofitting of electric vehicles. Now I'll invite Mr. Nakul to share his experience and give some insights on the retrofitting of the heavy vehicles. So, Mr. Nakul.
Hello everyone, this is Nakul from Cell Propulsion. Firstly, I would like to thank WRI for giving me this opportunity to talk about what we are doing and as well as the making a case for converting vehicles to electric. So a quick introduction about us. We are a relatively recent company, started out in February 2017 and started building out various components that become part of the electric vehicle powertrain. And these powertrains can be used as a conversion kit or even can be used for new vehicles. We are based out of Bangalore. We have commercialized these components for the light electric vehicle segment, and right now we are scaling this up for heavy commercial vehicles. Coincidentally, we are focusing on conversion of a bus to electric, a diesel bus to electric. And since Mr. Shalendra has talked about conversion of light electric vehicles, I would focus more on the use case and potential of retrofits in the electric bus and electric truck segment. I am one of the founders. My co-founder Paras and Supratim take care of the technology development and operations of the company. I look mostly after the fundraise and strategy, whereas Paras is mostly involved in battery pack design and daily operation, and Supratim takes care of all the mechatronic systems. Beginning with the current status, as Mr. Shalendra pointed out, this industry is in a very nascent stage. Not many vehicles on the road today have been converted to retrofit, have been converted to electric as of now, or even to hybrids. The way we see the conversion and retrofit technology is that it will supplement the production of new electric vehicles, because the current capability and even the capability and production which the OEMs are planning to develop in coming years will not suffice the actual demand for electric vehicles, and hence conversion can become a very good supplement to that production and supply of new electric vehicles. As of today, there is a lot of policy ambiguity at both national and state level. There is not that much ambiguity on the technological side because of the AIS 123 Part 3 standards that are there with ARAI and ICAT. So if you convert a vehicle, getting it homologated is very well defined, but how to get it certified from an RTO and deploy it on the road, and then even a subsidy for EV retrofits, are some of the open-ended points that are still being discussed, and you know, we are trying to pitch and push for these kind of policy changes to come in, which will give a good boost to EV retrofit industry as well. One of the major reasons why we have looked at EV retrofits right at the inception of our company is that they provide a lower barrier to entry compared to a new vehicle production, which requires a massive capital investment as well as certification requirements. Our understanding of the retrofit market, and as Mr. Shalendra also pointed out, the amount of vehicles that are on the road, looking at that, we feel that EV conversion, even only on heavy commercial vehicle side, which is your electric bus and electric trucks, is a big enough market to and a big enough opportunity to capture and as well as bring in some benefit to the society and environment. S- some of the problems that we see and we are trying to solve with for the EV retrofit industry is the lack of indigenous technology for the components. Lot of work that has happened in the conversion kit and retrofitting domain has, you know, been done by sourcing components from China or from some other countries and doing a system integration of putting them together. We feel that this approach will not help bring down the cost of conversion and meet the expectation of consumers. So this is one major area of focus for us at Cell Propulsion, to develop all of these components indigenously, control their specifications as well as control their costs. Because for different vehicle segments and for different use cases, there is a requirement of lot of customization as well for these components, and controlling and building them in-house allows us to bring in this customization at a very competitive pricing for our customers. Another not so direct advantage that we see with working with EV conversion is that they help build that awareness about electric vehicle technology among the customers. And many of the customers that we have interacted with have shown that they are not that open to convert and make a change and move on to electric vehicles. This is where we tell them that you can convert some of your vehicles to electric from your existing fleet and gain experience and feedback of how electric vehicle technology compares to IC engine technology, and then take a major decision of, you know, transitioning your entire fleet to electric. And that can be new vehicles or as well as conversion of existing vehicles. So this lack of awareness and lack of commitment to transition to electric is something we feel that EV conversion is a very good stepping stone to solve this problem as well. One of the so here I talk about what we have built as a powertrain for the commercial vehicles. We have four major components when we look at electric bus. That is your motor controller, motors, battery management system, battery packs, the on off-board charger. The electric buses don't have an onboard charger. They always depend upon an external charging source and a telematics module. And these various components have been built over the past couple of years by us and are being integrated as a system to convert existing diesel bus to electric. Some of the major issues that we have seen here are in the area of motor drives and electric motors. These two components are not that readily available for high voltages like 600 to 800 volts and for high power output of 150 to 200 kilowatts. And not only their availability is constrained, even developing them is not that straightforward a task, and getting them built and out into the field has been one of the major feats that we have achieved here at Cell Propulsion. And we feel that these two components bring in lot of value to the customers in, you know, optimizing the mileage for them, as well as, you know, giving them a good ride experience, as well as a lot of faith in performance of converted electric vehicles. This we have discussed earlier also. AIS 123 part 3 provides all the required guidelines to convert a vehicle full to electric, and this essentially takes care of brings in a lot of clarity on the technology side to build out such kits. A major problem that needs to be solved is to make them commercially viable, because as the requirement of range goes up, the amount of battery required leads to a very large increase in the cost of the kit. And then the customers feel that for an old vehicle they are spending so much, where, you know, the optimization and trying to indigenize these components help us save some costs, but all lot of efforts have to be still put in to reduce the price and make these kits cost competent. One of the major areas where we see a lot of innovation that can happen is devising new unique business models to drive adoption for EV retrofitting. And we have seen players trying out different things. Two of the major business models that we are also bullish about are revitalization of classic cars, where we see that it's not more about the price and it's more about getting that performance and retaining their old asset. So this is one model which we see we can drive adoption of converted electric vehicles into the market, as well as another way of working that we see holds a lot of promise is we don't ask customers to give us an old vehicle. We ourselves source an old vehicle, convert it to electric, and present it to the customers as a pre-owned vehicle, which is which they can buy instead of buying a new diesel vehicle. And we feel that this approach also creates a kind of an after-sale market for electric vehicles, so that as over the years we electric vehicle retrofits grow and new electric vehicles kind of become old, they will also have a vibrant pre-sale, pre-owned market to move into. One of the major concerns which have been highlighted earlier also is lack of subsidy under FAME II for retrofitting. And we feel that this one policy change will be a very big encouragement for EV retrofit, and actually will help us achieve parity with diesel vehicles. This is the solution that we are offering to our customers on the electric bus side, where we are converting a 16-ton diesel bus to electric and providing a 200-kilometer range. And we are doing this with the local state transport authority here in Bangalore, BMTC. And this converted vehicle will be out on the roads in another 2 months. And then subsequently we'll be taking this kit out to a lot of bus operators that we are talking to, and we'll start scaling up the production during the next year. This is our understanding of the potential of retrofitting buses and various challenges involved in them. Some of the numbers that were released by Niti Aayog last year were that there are currently 1.5 million buses on Indian roads, and to support urbanization that's going to happen in the next decade, this number is going to double. Out of this, around 30% are with the state transport authorities, and the remaining 70% is owned by private operators. Over the next 3-4 decades, all of these would be either replaced by electric buses or will have to be converted or upgraded. We feel that this kind of a number or a demand can only be met by supplementing new electric buses with converted retrofitted buses. And as I have mentioned earlier, some of the major challenges that we see in achieving this target is lack of a supply chain or a production facility for cells, and availability of advanced electric motors, which not only add to the pricing but also makes it difficult to customize your end product for the customer. We feel, and apart from this, a major technological challenge where we see a lot of work is happening and a few in future will have better solutions, is providing electrification for intercity buses who travel more than 500 to 600 kilometers a day. And that essentially is where we feel that we'll start seeing some real maturity and some real traction with retrofits as well as new electric buses. So I hope I am completed my presentation well in time, and thank you. And I hand it over to Shravani for and taking this further for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Nakul, for such a wonderful presentation. Now I'll hand it over to Dr. Parveen for some of the questions. We have received a number of questions from our participants. So first we'll do the question answer round. And I see that, you know, like a lot of people have logged in a little bit later than when it started. So I think they have missed out on a few information. So I'll conclude with that, like in the end. So I give it to Dr. Parveen now for the questions.
Thank you, Shroni. So the first question we have about the policy and regulation for retrofitted EVs. And I think we can ask to Mr. Shalendra can answer this. So question is about the certification, quality of component and safety. So one of the participants has asked that the government notification is there for the vehicle less than 3,500 kg. So is there any notification or the government support is there for the electric for vehicle retrofitting more than that weight, like 3,500 kg? Is this clear?
Yes.
Hello?
Shall yes, I take the question?
Mr. Shalendra, I would like to answer this question. So this question about the government notification to allow the vehicles less than 3,500 kg for the retrofitting. So is there any notification for the heavy vehicles, or what is and participant want a clarification on this one?
Mr. Shalendra, if you can unmute yourself because you're muted. Yeah.
I think.
Okay.
Nakul, you would like to answer this question?
Yeah.
So regarding the conversion of vehicles heavier than 3.5 tons, there have been some amendments and some changes are in the pipeline. What we have seen is that for the specific segment of conversion of buses, in fact, couple of buses were converted. One of the first vehicles that were ever converted in this country, and they went through a special route for certification and everything. And this was done, I think, by KPIT few years ago in 2014 or 2015. So. This notification or amendments to AIS or updates, I would say rather, are not a big challenge. If some people or companies are attempting converting vehicles from 3.5 tons to within 10 tons, your MCV category, it's not going to be a major issue. And that kind of conversion can be attempted without, without any major bottlenecks.
Thank you. So the other question is about which vehicle segment is the most suitable candidate for the retrofitting in India. Some of the participants has asked that whether converting two-wheeler or three-wheeler is more viable, or the heavy vehicles or the freight vehicles.
Okay, so what I would like to clarify here is that the AIS 123 standards talk about conversion of vehicles beginning from three-wheelers. As such, there are no provisions for conversion of existing two-wheelers to electric. The thought process behind that has been that the amount of effort required to convert an existing two-wheeler to electric is more or less going to be similar in getting a new electric vehicle homologated. This is from the technology side. From the commercial side also, once you sit down and start doing numbers, what you will see is that it's just not easy to build out a proper commercial case or economic case for converting two-wheelers to electric. You need to have many more, a much larger value of the vehicle to actually justify to the customer that a small fraction of that is what they are paying to convert their vehicles to electric. It's very difficult to achieve this balance in electric two-wheelers. So beginning three-wheelers all the way up to buses or trucks even are the most viable vehicle segments for conversion.
Okay, so now I think Mr. Shalendra is available with us. So next question I can ask to Mr. Shalendra. So this, the next question is about, are there any criteria to decide on retrofit of different vehicle segments, that age of the vehicle, and what are the criteria when you select the vehicle for the retrofitting?
So I think Nakul has covered that partly, but let me say it again. The criteria really, the main criteria would be two, the technological feasibility and the commercial aspects. Because at the end of the day, we have to keep the customer in mind. So technically it makes sense, or technically it is feasible really in large scale to convert all kinds of vehicles, from two-wheelers all the way up to big buses and trucks. But commercially, two-wheelers and three-wheelers will be far more difficult to be commercially viable as retrofits. Three-wheelers may still be, because of the nature of the vehicle, it's a commercial vehicle. So if you can let it run for 100, 150 kilometers a day, the commercial viability will still come. But the real case for retrofits is for four-wheelers, both cars and commercial vehicles, and then for larger vehicles.
Okay, and there is a lot of question about the performance of the retrofitted electric vehicles. So some of the participants has asked that how the performance of retrofitted EV compares with the new vehicles.
I think Mr. Shalendra can go for that question as well, because like we're looking at if there are any key performance indicators or any standards where we can compare like a retrofitted vehicle to a normal electric vehicle, like a brand new one. So are there any criteria, or like how do we decide on the performance? So on you go, Mr. Shalendra.
Performance is in two parts. It is either in terms of speed, action, and that kind of performance, or performance is in terms of and fuel consumption. Now, a retrofit solution can be tuned to achieve needs in varying degrees. And here I'm talking about a hybrid. A full electric retrofit will definitely be operationally less expensive than a combustion engine vehicle, simply because of the nature of an electric motor, which we are all aware of. And it can be designed to be more than a combustion engine. You know, if your engine is a 30 kilowatt engine, you can put a 25 kilowatt motor and it will give a better performance, better feel. Now, but really whether it is better in terms of efficiency or better in terms of power, the question of tuning, that's up to the manufacturer and the customer to decide what is to be achieved, and that can be done. The technical feasibility lies for achieving both of these superior performances. In our case, for hybrid retrofit, we focused on efficiency so that fuel consumption and pollution can be reduced. That being a greater requirement of the target market, which is a commercial market, both cargo and passenger. But if there are individual customers or others who want, you know, a greater pickup, greater acceleration, that can be done as well.
You'd like to add this something?
Yeah, I would like to add just one aspect to this. One thing that I would like to emphasize here is that for electric vehicles, compared to the IC vehicles, there is a change in handling characteristic also, the handling performance. And it takes a little getting used to. And once what we have seen is that the customers start using electric vehicles and get adapted to the handling of the converted vehicle like that, they always kind of prefer driving that compared to a IC vehicle. And this thing generally doesn't come up either in a technical or a commercial discussions, but it's this qualitative aspect of comfort and the way vehicle is being driven, which also has a lot of impact subsequent to conversion, subsequent to sale to the customer, which I feel personally is superior to an IC engine.
Okay, thank you. So one comment we have from the participants, so I will share with you, and then both of you can give your view of that. So one of the participants has mentioned that retrofit of EVs will create a pool of manpower for EV repair, or it gives an opportunity to existing mechanics for reskilling. So this is like skill development side. So I think Mr. Shalendra can share his view on this, and then Nakul can comment.
I think this is a very important point and very perceptive comment. There is a lot of talk going around today that because of maintenance requirements of electric vehicles, job losses are falling. And that is another advantage of retrofits. Large proportion of the service industry in oils, when we are talking about retrofits. See, mechanics typically will have mechanical engineering skills, some electrical engineering, but getting the vehicle to function properly. The retrofitting business will then learn about electric vehicles in a more painless manner without job losses, and it establishes the ecosystem which is necessary for full scale future. And I think that I'm very pleased that the participant made this comment, because it's extremely important to the macroeconomic perspective on electrification of vehicles.
Thank you, Mr. Shalendra.
Nakul?
Nakul, you can give your comment on this.
Yeah, what Mr. Shalendra has said is quite accurate, and you know, we also fully believe that the retrofit market would be that next option for the IC engine mechanic shops. As IC engine numbers go down, we feel that they would have to upskill themselves and capture this opportunity where they start offering services of converting existing IC vehicles to electric. So apart from that, what we also feel is that this upskilling will also enable them to get into, you know, provide ancillary services like, you know, installing charging stations at their garages or at their workshops, to build out that citywide charging network. So we feel that these workshops have a very important role to play in this actual execution of electric vehicle conversion to electric at scale.
Thanks, Nakul. Now I'll hand over to my colleague, Shravani.
Thank you, speakers, and thank you, audience, for having such a wonderful session on like retrofitting for electric vehicles. I would like to especially thank our speakers for giving such wonderful presentations on their journey and experience of retrofitting in their respective organizations. Also, thank you, Dr. Parveen, for moderating this session and handling the questions of our audiences so well. See, because like we've noticed, like a few of the attendees have logged on to us a little bit later on. So I would like to, you know, like make a brief about what we started initially, that if you have missed it out again, so please bear with me. So this webinar was organized by WRI India as a part of the project, the Electric Mobility Forum, which was, you know, like, which is still running by the kind support of our donors, the Shakti Sustainable Foundation. And as many of you have attended our last webinars, we have always tried to cover some very crucial topics revolving around the topic of electric mobility. The last webinar was on the topic of standardizing of electric vehicles charging infrastructure, which was the speaker was Dr. Sajid Mubashir. So as like today, we had a tremendous participation rate in that webinar as well, and we received wonderful comments and questions from our audience. So what we tried to do was gather all of them and try to create a small knowledge product, which we'll be publishing soon. So similarly, today we discussed a very important topic as well around retrofitting of electric vehicles, and by our two significant speakers, Mr. Nakul Kukar, who is a CEO and co-founder of Cell Propulsion, and Mr. Shalendra Gupta, the CFO and the co-founder of Altigreen Propulsion Labs. Thank you both of you, and it was amazing to learn your perspectives to you know, like of retrofitting to like how you've been to your journey. Then the key point that I would like to mention here is that before registering or starting this session, we have received a tremendous amount of comments and questions and also thoughts from various people who are also involved in this sector. So we are really keen on knowing your part and your journey as well on the topic of retrofitting. So why don't you guys just, you know, like send me a 2-page write-up mentioning your experience, challenges, potentials, and expectations in the mail that is given in the link. I would still repeat, that is shravani.sharma@wri.org. And we will try to collect as many of them and have a compilation of the same and publish a small knowledge product of it. Please also do not forget to mention your name, your designation, and your organization in that material which you'll be sending. So come on, guys, send all of your stories and let many people know about like what you guys are doing in your respective fields. And let's spread the word of the amazing work that you guys are doing in this. Because I think there's not much of an awareness about retrofitting in India. So it's important that we guys take the step and spread the word. Also, in case if you guys have missed the initial part of the presentation, please don't be worried, because we'll be uploading both the presentations after this webinar ends, and the link will be shared to you. It will be on the same link, so you don't have to worry about like a new link. So yeah, that's all for today. Thank you for your participation. Thank you for all your time, and we hope to see you in the next webinar that will be arranged by WRI India with the support of Shakti as a part of the Electric Mobility Forum and WRI Engage. Thank you, Parveen. Thank you, speakers.
Thank you.
Bye.